Well, good morning, everyone. Space, getting trapped on the moon and rescuing our astronauts and the stress they had to go through versus used car presentation. So like Bill said, we're a perfect follow-up for this. But it's really great to be here. I'm sure everyone is, having a good time. There's a lot to learn. This is one of the unique events where you have all kinds of people from all different facets of our business. So we're really happy to be here. Larry and I are NADA Used Car Guide, part of J.D. Power. Today, both Larry and I are experts on new and used vehicle prices. And today, we're going to talk about how the history of used vehicle prices can help us predict the future. So first, I'm going to start with just a quick, how did we get here? Now, all of you know that used vehicle prices have reached historical highs. And there was even talk a couple years about the used car prices being in a bubble. Used car market is just out of control. And when you really look at it, it's all rational and the data's all there behind it to understand exactly what occurred. So what happened in the past 7 years or so? Well, one thing that occurred is we had used supply decline dramatically. And that was really one of the primary drivers behind the increases in used vehicle prices. So from 2007, so pre-recession, to 2014, used vehicle supply went down about 26%. Now, that wasn't the only thing that was happening. In addition to that, we had historically low interest rates, incredibly low interest rates. The lenders had access to capital. The lenders were ready to lend to consumers who, by the way, had lowered their personal debt and were ready to borrow. So we had the perfect credit environment. On top of that, our economy was recovering, the jobs were recovering, 8.7 million jobs were lost, but in 2010 we had consistent job gains, and we've actually replaced all those jobs and we've added even more. So people had jobs, people could go buy cars. Now on top of that, the pent-up demand that occurred during the recession, people still wanted to buy stuff. It's not like you don't want to buy stuff. You just can't, or you don't feel comfortable doing it. So all those people that pulled out of the new vehicle market when we hit 10.4 in 2009, and with those gradual increases, all those people started coming back to the market. New vehicle demand was just on fire. Prices were increasing. Incentives were in decline. So all these things came together, and guess what? Used vehicle prices skyrocketed, 18% increase from 2007 to 2014. So no bubble, fundamentals, all drove prices up. So understanding data can tell you, hey, we know what's happening in the market today, and we could look at the drivers that created this market. So let's continue. Now we're in today. Now one variable that's changed dramatically and quickly, I would say, is new vehicle sales. So new vehicle sales in 2016 are relatively flat to 2015. So that growth that we've seen, that nice growth, has stopped. But it's a little bit worse than that. So that the flat market that we're experiencing this year is not driven by retail demand. It's actually increasing primarily because of fleet sales. Retail sales are down 2%, fleet sales are up 7%. So we're in a flat market, but we're in a market where retail demand is going down. Now, and people talk about that pent-up demand. The pent-up demand is spent. But in fact, I would argue that now we're even going farther than just spent-up demand. We're like borrowing some demand. We're pulling ahead. And the way we're doing it is with incentives. So what you're looking at here is a long-term incentive chart. And all the way at the end, that peak, that's us. $3,900 on average per unit for incentives. And you hear a lot about price increases, and it's great, and incentives, they're going up, but prices are going up too. But when you look at it that way too, incentives as a percentage of MSRP is 11%. So that's really high. You gotta go all the way back to the recession to see this kind of incentive spending. So pent-up demand is spent, but now we're pulling these buyers ahead by giving them incentives to come into the market and keep our new vehicle sales flat. So we're in a much worse situation than just flat sales. We're now pulling sales forward. Now, with that recovery, and now the flattening out, but now we're at a high level of new vehicle sales, and we've been that way for a few years, used supply, of course, is naturally gonna come back. So we're looking now at the biggest youth supply increase we've seen in a while, in a really long while, 2016 from 2015 to 2016, double-digit increase, 12% increase in that pool of 0 to 5-year-old vehicles. So the nearly new vehicles, that pool is up 12%. And if you dig deeper into this data, for lease maturities, they're up 33%. So you have this huge influx now of nearly new vehicles, which is a great thing, right? Available inventory, you remember, you go back 4 years, and dealers were scrounging to find these vehicles. So now they're readily available. We're in an environment that even though, you know, demand is kind of coming down a little bit, demand's still strong. We're in a good economy, but prices, obviously, when you think about just these two variables, and there's other variables as well that are changing, but just these two variables are taking us from a historical high period of used prices. What you're looking at here is an index. You see that gray, not the gray area yet, but you see where we plateaued up here for the past few years. And you look at the history. We're way above history, all that driven by those fundamentals that I talked about earlier. And now we're kind of coming down back to earth. A nice soft landing, so to speak. No bubble, just reality. Metrics are changing. We're moving into a new paradigm of prices are going to go down from historical highs. And in fact, calendar year to date, according to our data, 0 to 8-year-old vehicles are down 4%. So used car market is in decline because fundamentals are changing that are putting pressure, downward pressure on used vehicles, and we're moving out of a period that was unprecedented anyway. So that's great. So you have data, you can explain what occurred, you can explain why it occurred, you could even come up with predictions on what's going to occur. And we have so much data now. We have data that can tell us, for example, I can look at time series data and I can tell you that full-size pickups during the last 2 years have depreciated 6%. Meanwhile, subcompact cars have depreciated 20%. So I know that. I could look at data and figure that out. I could also tell you that 25 Honda Accords are selling within the zip code of 93109 for an average price of 20,000 units. I could tell you all kinds of things with data. That's like telling you how it is, what's happening today, what happened before. But how do I tell you about the future? Now, all this data is given analysts like me, and couple that with the computer power. I mean, you think about what Jim had to deal with these mainframe computers. I mean, shoot, your desktop computer is probably as powerful as what they were using at NASA to get people back from the moon. And so we have all this stuff. So there's a propensity to go, wow, I have all this data. I have all this computing power. I'm going to build a model. And that model is going to give me some really good results that I could talk to you about. And here's how I'm going to answer the question when you ask me, so how'd you come up with this estimate? I'm going to say, because the model said so. Now, is that a good answer? Well, you run into it anywhere. You know, you could also ask Jim, your used car salesman, why are you buying full-size pickups? Because I know. Or you ask your risk analyst and you say, you know, why are we going to skew more towards mid-size CUVs? Because we've done it before, we're going to do it again. So you're using this history, or I'm using these statistics, and I'm maybe not giving you the full story. I'm not really trying to deceive you or anything like that, but I put it in a model, it cranks something out, and maybe I don't have a thorough understanding of the variables in that model, and give you the ammunition you have to really make good decisions. Because telling you that prices are going to go down 6%, and maybe you got to focus more on worry about the subcompact cars or worried about full-size trucks, great, but what do I do with it? So what we did at J.D. Power, and what I recommend for everyone and demand from anyone that's providing this type of data to you, is you got to look at things in parts. So we think forecasting is the sum of many parts. Now, we break these parts into easily explainable and digestible type of topics. So one, you got macroeconomic. So when I'm forecasting, remember, all we're doing, I'm taking all that historical data, I know what happened, I backtest, I look at all the stuff that I think created where we are today, all easy stuff, and then I look at, okay, here's today, here's our macroeconomic indicators, how's it gonna be different next year, year after that, year after that? So figure that out. Then you got demographics. You gotta understand how many people really wanna buy cars, how many people are getting their licenses, how many cars per household, how many miles are being demanded. You gotta understand, where's future demand going? You have all these forecasts out there, but having a really thorough understanding of where natural demand is important. You need to know the competitive environment. 3 years ago, buying a compact SUV or residualizing compact, CUVs, was easy, and they were really high. And then, but you had to think, you know, they were on a huge uptick. You have to understand, I'm in a different environment today or 3 years ago compared to today. Now, you have all these new models coming in, you know, pricing pressure in that segment, you got more used supply. You really have to think of competitive environment today and in the future. And especially when you think about vehicle design, manufacturers are doing a really good job at shortening that life cycle. So a lot of times, a vehicle that's strong today is going to be facing much more extreme competition than in the future. In addition, the easiest one to predict is supply volume. Once again, that's the one variable you really always have a really good handle on. But it changes. Supply today is going to be, in the future, is going to be much different. In fact, by 2018, our used supply of 0 to 8 year old vehicles is actually going to get back to those pre-recession historical levels that were fueled by all those strong sales in the past. So we're actually going to face the same supply pool pretty soon. We're not there yet, but pretty soon. So you take each component, and then you got to look at it and say, okay, well, what's important within the macro economy? Now we think, and you might think something different, we're all thinking different things, but you're really trying to find independent variables that help explain the volatility that you expect to occur in the future, right? So we look at several things that are pretty obvious. You want to know, okay, consumers are making X today, what are they going to make in the future? How much disposable income are they going to have? And that's an indicator of demand, right? We know we need to understand gas prices. Almost impossible to forecast. Everyone thinks they know, and yeah, they're going to be stable now, but 2 years ago, we thought they were going to be $4. It always changes. You never know, but you do your best to try to predict it because the gas price movement is going to impact segments differently. You need to understand some sort of wealth indicator. We use housing prices. You could use the Dow. You could use S&P. You could use whatever you want, but you want to understand a general indicator of wealth. And then, you need to understand credit. Now, what we do with these, so you identify variables you think are important, you want to get those into your model, but the way you get them in your model is you have to find long-term independent variables that have a good history, that have some stability in them, and that you can reasonably forecast. So when you break into credit, here's what we do. We have a credit, well, we call it a credit composite, because it's made up of several variables that are all, most of them are free, all of them are free. You go out, so we have, for our credit composite, we have credit availability, comes from the banks. We take the 48-month loan rate. We look at third-party forecasts of where credit is going. We look at household debt ratio, and we look at 10-year treasury. And we take all these variables, and we predict those into the future, and we put those together based on, you know, our opinion of how they should be weighted, and we create our assumption of where credit is heading. Now, we do that for every variable in the model, which, of course, I don't have time to go through now, but that's how you do it. You go in, you define, you figure out, you use your business acumen, you use your expertise, you figure out what makes sense, what needs to be in there, then you figure out what metrics need to go in there. And what this does for you is I can now come to Chrysler Financial and talk about, hey, you know, the credit market's going to get worse. And here's why I think it's going to get worse. And here's the metrics I have. And they might tell me, oh, you're wrong on this. We use this. And that flexibility enables you to take another independent variable, throw it in your model, see if it helps your predictive quality of the model. So lots of flexibility when you have a foundation like this set up for your forecasting. I would demand that for anyone doing forecasting for you. And if you're not doing forecasting, I would recommend doing forecasting because the market is changing. So that's one thing. The macroeconomic stuff, cool. You know, I can figure out where the industry's going, I can figure out where the segments are going, but the one thing about automotive, and that's what's kept me in this business for 20 years, is the fact that we pretty much have the coolest stuff that people want to buy. I mean, cars are cool. You don't just buy a car because, you know, you pick, you know, your TV, you know, you just, other commodities, it's just commodities. Maybe you pick it on attributes, but a car is an emotional purchase, and it's a big purchase, and it's an important purchase. So I could do forecasting and forecast the mid-sized car segment, but guess what I'm going to miss? I'm going to miss the difference between a Toyota Camry and a Fusion and an Altima and an Accord. I have to really understand the product. So another component of our model, besides the, you know, general forecasting bit, is we're looking at vehicles and looking at how these different vehicles are, well, you can easily figure out price difference, but we want to understand, so what makes an Audi a different price than a BMW? What makes a Ford, what makes a Ford Fusion a different price than a Nissan Altima is really what you're looking at. And once again, we want to break it up into components that I can explain and I can find variables to help understand. So I might know that the difference between vehicle A and vehicle B is $1,200. What's that worth to you? Not much. You could have figured that out too. All you need is some data. You look at it. Okay. There's a premium for this vehicle versus that vehicle. So what we've done, though, is try to figure out, for OEMs especially, you know, where are the deficiencies of your vehicle? And for if you're holding vehicles in your portfolio or buying vehicles, you want to know, too, is a Ford Fusion more sensitive to gas prices than a Honda Accord? You want to understand all these things at the vehicle level, because guess what? People buy an individual vehicle. They don't buy a segment. So you really have to understand what those individual vehicles are doing. So we broke it up into four components again: brand, design, market, and performance. We do this at the vehicle level. Our model breaks up brand into, we look at brand, we break it up into several components, pretty obvious stuff. What's the initial quality? What kind of strategies behind the vehicle? Like, for example, where are they gonna price it relative to where we think transaction prices are? What's their volume? What's their historical volume? Things like that. What's the emotional appeal? How does that brand resonate with the consumer? And obviously you have longer term reliability, especially important when you're thinking about forecasting for leases. So lucky for us, a component like reliability, which really reliability could be, you know, it's kind of a subjective concept if you think about it. You know, what does reliability mean? Well, to us, it means several things, and luckily we have some metrics that we have access to at a level that's much more granular than the public. We look at reliability as a component of VDS. That's a J.D. Power survey. It's called Vehicle Dependability Study. It looks at three-year-old vehicles and asks consumers, how reliable they are, down to minutia. So you get a lot of consumer responses and you get an understanding of a vehicle's reliability. We have an avoider study, which is really cool and really straightforward. Basically ask people, did you avoid vehicle A because you were concerned about reliability? And if there are a lot of people say yes, you kind of assume that consumers at least perceive that that vehicle has a problem. And then on this one, there's a hard measure too, like how long does that vehicle actually last before it goes to the scrappage? Once again, we break all these things down into the components, we break it all down into these independent variables, and we create a forecasting model that we believe offers you guidance and insight on what is actually happening, and more importantly, offers you granularity to actually be able to understand, well, some things are out of your control, of course, but actually gives you granularity to understand, like, how am I influencing some of these variables, or enables you to create and cater different types of statistical models that really reflect your actual business performance. So an easy example would be a manufacturer that spends a lot of time and effort on remarketing. Their remarketing performance might be completely different than what I would perceive looking at the market as a whole. So you're able to integrate individual strategies and all your efforts at whatever you're doing into your forecast modeling, enabling you to really strategically align your decisions with an outcome that you can predict and then measure that outcome. And that's really the key: prediction, measurement, and being able to make a strategic decision. So that's really what we think is important and everyone should be thinking about as we move into a market where before we just made decisions and good things happened. Now when we make decisions, there's more headwinds and really more downside risk. So now that I've given you kind of the conceptual stuff, Larry will get into the actual application of what our model does.
Thanks, Jonathan. So we're running short on time, so forgive me, I'm going to breeze through this here, but to put some of what Jonathan talked about into practical terms. So looking ahead, the factors that brought us here to this point, or brought used vehicle prices to all-time highs, well, they're going to see prices decline over the forecast period over the next few years. So specifically, incentives and credit, we see putting downward pressure on used vehicle prices from an incentive standpoint. Jonathan talked about it. Incentives are at all-time highs. Incentives as a percent of MSRP continue to move higher and higher and higher. So that, of course, will create downward pressure on used vehicle prices. From a credit standpoint, credit has just been, from a historic standpoint, absolutely fabulous. Perhaps never better. So there's really only one way for credit conditions to go, and that's to skew more toward the negative. And again, the biggest impact to used prices that we see moving forward is that growth in used vehicle supply. As far as supply is concerned, over the next several years, we see supply returning back to pre-recession levels, and this is supply of vehicles up to 5 years old. So we're looking at a growth rate of 9% between 2016 and 2018. Again, that'll put us back to where we were prior to 2007. So supply is, it's grown quite a bit to date, but we still have a fair amount of growth yet to realize. As far as used prices are concerned, we expect that prices of vehicles up to 5 years old, this is a little bit different from the normal index that we share with the industry, which goes up to 8 years old, but we expect prices of used vehicles up to 5 years old to decline by 9% through 2020, so that is 9% from today, 2016 through 2020. It's going to be a little bit worse if you factor in the decline that we've experienced this year. But essentially, that's going to put prices back to pre-recession levels. So what the past cycle giveth, the new cycle will taketh away. So you see that all those gains that we've experienced over the past, you know, 5, 6, 7 years, those are going to be taken away by the conditions that are the factors that I just talked about. Now, more specific terms, I'm going to talk about compact cars and large pickups, two segments that are really polar opposites of one another, both from a physical size standpoint, but also from a market performance standpoint. Compact cars, it should come as no surprise to the group that compact car demand has been especially weak over the past year to 2 years in particular, and that's primarily due to that consumer shift in preference away from cars and over to utilities, particularly compact and increasingly subcompact utilities. But compact car sales are down 5% year to date, which compares to essentially flat sales overall for the industry overall. And the segment share of new vehicle sales has fallen from 15% in 2013 to about 12% this year. So over a short period of time, we've seen pretty rapid erosion in demand and sales for the small car segment. And that decline in sales has come despite significant increases in incentive spend. Incentives are up 8% year to date to an average of $2,700 per unit. You can see that there's been a pretty dramatic increase in incentives over the past several years. There hasn't been a let up since 2010 there. And those incentives are particularly pronounced on for leasing, lease subvention. So we can see that leasing is helping to prop up new compact car deliveries. Lease penetration or lease share of fleet sales is at 33% year to date. That's up dramatically from last year, and that exceeds what we've seen from mainstream vehicles overall. And that growth in lease penetration has seen lease volume increase by 9%, while retail purchase volume is down by 14%. So if it weren't for leasing, that 5% decline in new vehicle deliveries overall would likely be much more significant. Manufacturers are spending an average of over $4,000 per unit on compact cars. $4,000, when the average compact car MSRP, it's about $22,000. That is a significant sum of money. That subvention is helping to keep monthly payments low. The difference in monthly payment between a lease and a vehicle that's been purchased and financed has grown from $90 in 2013 to $110 so far this year. So a $20 difference, okay, where purchase prices have gone up, or finance prices, excuse me, have gone up, where monthly payments, where lease monthly payments have stayed flat. Why wouldn't you want to lease a car in that type of environment rather than to purchase it? Now, leasing, of course, helps prop up new vehicle deliveries, but it also adds, artificially, to used vehicle supply. So looking ahead for the compact car segment, we see used supply, lease off-lease supply growing by 11% over the next few years. If there's a silver lining here, it's that total supply for the car segment will grow by an average of just 2% moving forward. So that will help support prevent more significant declines in used vehicle prices for the segment. So looking at the variable impact for prices moving forward, similar to what we've talked about for the market overall, credit, incentives, as well as increased supply will be the primary drivers behind declining prices in the future for the compact car segment. Gasoline prices, conversely, we expect to add something of a lift. We do expect gasoline prices to increase. Yes, they're difficult to forecast, but given where they are at very low levels, particularly compared to where we've been, again, similar to credit, we only see things moving up in the future. So we expect the gas will add a little bit of a bump to the segment moving forward. From a price standpoint, we expect that compact car prices will drop by 6% from 2016 to 2020. That would essentially put prices back on par with where they were in 2008 when we saw gasoline prices reach an all-time high of, I think it was $4.11. Again, 6% over a four-year period of time, that's not as bad as the 6% decline that we've seen over the past 2 to 3 years. So again, you want to look at things as an optimist or glass half full, you know, look at it that way. Now, large pickups. Large pickups, they've been one of the most exceptional segments in terms of new vehicle sales and prices and used vehicle prices as well. From a new vehicle price standpoint, large pickup prices have grown by 17% for new pickups over the past 3 years. That's second only to the large SUV increase of 20%. From a used price standpoint, we can see that prices grew by 17% from 2013 through 2016, or I think that's 2012 through 16. That's quite exceptional. Depreciation for the segment has averaged 6%, just 6% since 2011. Again, that's quite incredible when you consider that overall industry depreciation is around 11 to 13%, so half of what we've seen from an industry standpoint. And of course, much of that growth in pricing is due to lower supply. The fall off in new vehicle sales led to a 40% decline in large truck, large pickup supply, which of course has helped greatly to lift used large pickup prices. That being said, large pickup supply is growing. It will continue to increase over the next several years, and that will add consistently downward pressure to used vehicle prices. Now, as far as incentives are concerned, in new vehicle pricing, we've seen incentives over the past several years for the segment really quite low, particularly when you put it into MSRP terms. We've seen a steady, consistent decline in incentive spend as a percent of MSRP. However, we've seen that flatten out over the past 2 years. Given the outlook for flat large pickup sales moving forward, flat industry sales, but flat large pickup sales as well moving forward, we expect incentives to start to eat into MSRP over the next several years. So incentives will also act as a drag. Again, the variable impact to the segment, supply, the primary component that will bring prices down over the next several years, as well as incentives and the erosion, the slow erosion in credit, but also gasoline prices. You know, it's the counter to what we saw with compact cars. Higher gasoline prices won't help large pickups. Now, from an incentive standpoint, we do not expect incentives to hurt large pickups nearly as much as we do for compact cars. As far as our forecast is concerned, we expect large pickup prices to fall by 7% from 2016 to 2020. That's a fairly steep decline. Prices for the segment haven't fallen yet. In fact, we expect a slight increase this year compared to last year. And on one hand, it seems fairly negative, but on the other hand, at the end of our forecast period, by the end of 2020, prices will still be back at 2014 levels. So really quite strong relative to the industry overall and to other segments, particularly car segments. So closing thoughts?
We passed our time, but clearly what we're trying to get at, use your data not only to be able to understand past performance, really use your data to understand what's happening in the future and get the data that you need that enables you to actually make decisions that help buttress your market expertise and help you make better decisions and make better planning, because we are in a situation that's going to be quite a bit different and more every variable really is a headwind right now for the used vehicle market, except for the fact that we have a huge opportunity with the supply coming back. So there's challenges here, but there's the challenges for are surmountable, and the growth and the opportunity is huge as long as we make the right decisions.
Yeah, the key is making smart, informed decisions as it relates to pricing. We all know that there's a great deal of untapped opportunity for used vehicles. Again, it's just staying on top of what's occurring from a price standpoint to ensure that you're just making smart pricing, purchasing, and buying decisions, selling decisions.
Thank you.
Very good. Jonathan, Larry, thank you very much.